presentation for this afternoon covers the drivers of the changes in the regulatory framework for the banking sector, that is, and the pivotal paradigm shift of supervisors after the global financial. After the global financial crisis, so I'll start with the changes after the Asian financial crisis. But don't worry, my presentation wouldn't take me 2 decades. And I'll move on to the factors that we believe would shape future regulation. So let me begin with a brief background on the changes in the regulatory framework after the Asian financial crisis. Dr. Lianto already alluded that one of the significant legislative pieces passed in the year 2000 is the General Banking Law. The General Banking Law has clearly set out the alignment of capital requirements with the international standards, including those prescribed by the Bank for International Settlements. The said law also prescribes fit and proper requirements for the Board of Directors and provides the rules to lending to related parties, particularly the directors, officers, stockholders, and related interests of banks. The banking reforms that were implemented aimed at strengthening the financial position and solvency of banks and set the bar higher in terms of quality of governance in the banking system. The measures that were put in place left the country relatively unscathed during the 2008 global financial crisis. Nonetheless, the BSP recognizes that we could likewise draw from the lessons learned by other jurisdictions and implement measures to further promote financial stability. The global financial crisis triggered the implementation of a series of regulatory reforms and challenged existing perspectives in supervision. Regulators across the globe identified significant weaknesses in the existing regulatory framework and came up with proposals aimed at building resilience in the global financial system. The Basel III capital adequacy framework is one of the significant reforms introduced. The framework provides standards and timelines to implement enhanced capital and liquidity rules and to ultimately promote a more resilient banking sectors. So jurisdictions across the globe endeavor to implement the revised capital and liquidity standards based on the effectivity date set by the Basel Committee. The BSP shares the same objective, though we also put significant weight on the conditions and setting of the local banking industry in pacing and sequencing the implementation of reforms. For instance, we adopted the Basel III minimum capital and capital conservation buffer requirements ahead. That's ahead of the effectivity date set by the Basel Committee. This is in view that the banking industry have more than adequate buffer to meet the new minimum requirements, and that their capital is comprised mostly of core or high quality capital. We believe that the early adoption of the capital standards will allow our banks to better formulate their strategies, considering the requirements of their business models. Now, this slide shows a summary of our Basel III-related issuances. It's not clear. Covering, among others, the requirements for domestic systemically important banks and the guidance or recovery plan or of a DC liquidity coverage ratio framework and the leverage ratio framework. What's unique in our jurisdiction is that when we implemented, for instance, the leverage ratio, and then the liquidity ratio and the requirements for the domestic systemically important banks, we adopted the monitoring period. So that would allow us a year or so to see if the standards set by the international setting standard bodies are actually applicable or if the banks could actually comply with those requirements. That would allow us, give us time to tweak the standards given our observations in the banking industry. So only the universal commercial banks are covered by the Basel III requirements. The standalone thrift and rural banks are actually covered with what we call, it's a localized version of actually Basel 1.5. So this is actually applying the proportionality principle. We believe that there's no one-size-fits-all model for the banking industry. So regulations have to be calibrated depending on the risks posed by the institutions to the industry. I would like to liken the proportionality principle with the children's story, Goldilocks and the Three Bears, wherein Goldilocks is trying to find the right warm porridge for her, the right size of bed, the right size of chair. So that's what proportionality is all about. So over and above the initiatives to strengthen the financial position of banks through enhanced solvency and liquidity standards, The global financial crisis also highlighted weaknesses in corporate governance, evident in excessive risk-taking and weak checks and balances. In this respect, regulators recognized the need to strengthen accountability of the board and senior management and echoed the expectation that the tone of good governance should come from the top. Related to this, the Basel Committee issued the paper Principles for Enhancing Corporate Governance, which was amended in 2015 with the issuance of Corporate Governance Principles for Banks. Following this issuance, the BSP issued Circular No. 749 in 2012 on the guidance in strengthening corporate governance in BSP supervised financial institutions. This was recently amended in August 2017 to align the same with the most recent issuance of the Basel Committee, and the provisions of our revised regulations are already aligned with the corporate governance guidelines for public sector entities issued by the Securities and Exchange Commission. Our issuance and our approach for promoting good governance in the financial industry is actually a three-phase governance reform agenda. So we started with the fit and proper requirements and expectations for the board of directors. This was followed by issuances promoting controls, checks and balances systems, covering the internal audit and compliance functions. And the third phase covered the issuance of standards and expectations governing the management of key risk areas such as credit, operational, and information technology. The BSP also issued guidelines to prevent the risk from related party abuses. The Asian region is generally characterized by large family groups or conglomerates with significant exposures in the financial sector. In the same vein, the Philippines have large conglomerates with mixed exposures to both the financial and non-financial sector. Again, I usually ask when I do presentation is that I would name the bank and the audience would name a mall associated to that bank. So in the interest of time, we wouldn't do that. So in this regard, the BSP issued regulations governing transactions with related parties. The issuance provides a definition of related parties that goes beyond the traditional DOSRI perimeter and covers a broader range of transactions. The related party transactions guidelines issued by the BSP was also adopted by the SEC and the Insurance Commission in their respective supervisory jurisdictions. We recognize that transactions between and among related parties create financial, commercial, and economic benefits to individual institutions and to the entire group where said institutions belong. In this regard, the issuance emphasizes that related party transactions are not prohibited, provided that these are done on arm's length terms. The guidelines on RPT aim to ensure that the interests of all stakeholders, especially the depositors, are protected. In addition to these regulatory reforms, another significant change triggered by the global financial crisis is the pivotal shift in supervision perspective. In particular, the noted gaps in financial supervision pertain to the fragmented assessment of the financial system and inadequate focus on conduct issues. These concerns were subsequently addressed by parallel reforms in supervisory approach. Supervisors are now equally concerned on risk exposure of individual institutions and the aggregate risk exposures of the financial industry. Basel Core Principles for Effective Banking Supervision, the set of standards used by supervisors to benchmark the effectiveness of their supervisory practices, was also revised to take into account macroprudential perspective in supervision. Microprudential or institution-specific activities now feed into and complement the macroprudential measures being implemented. In this regard, supervisors strengthen the regulatory framework covering these two perspectives. Now, the DSIB, domestic systemically important bank framework under the Basel III, for instance, covering increased capital requirements for the big banks, also takes into account the extent of interconnectedness of that bank or that specific institution in the industry. Similar to other jurisdictions, the BSP created a separate unit to oversee on a holistic scale the vulnerabilities of the financial system. The Banco Central also introduced macroprudential measures to ensure that the financial system will not be exposed to excessively high risks. This includes the real estate stress testing requirement for banks and enhanced reporting of their real estate exposures. An interagency body was also created to facilitate monitoring of system-wide risks and coordination across the financial sector. The Financial Stability Coordinating Committee, which is comprised of the Banco Central, the Securities and Exchange Commission, Insurance Commission, the Philippine Deposit Insurance Corporation, and the Bureau of the Treasury has an agreed framework to monitor the vulnerabilities of the financial sector. Another perspective challenged by the global financial crisis is the amount of attention being given to conduct issues. Some say that conduct issues resulted from the liberal application of principles-based regulation and supervision. This approach is different from the rule-based regime, where a defined list of rules or requirements on what may or may not be done is provided. The flexibility given in the principles-based approach in a way influence or shape behaviors falling within the gray area, and this exposed institutions to significant risks, including reputational risks. Now, conduct issues were addressed structurally in other jurisdictions by adopting the Twin Peaks model. It's actually adopted in the UK, France, Italy, and Netherlands. This generally segregates supervision of financial institutions into two main areas. The first is oversight of all financial institutions that could generate systemic risk concern, which houses supervision of all financial sector activities in one agency. Second, oversight on market conduct on all types of financial intermediaries, which ultimately aims to protect the depositors and investors. In the Philippines, although supervision is sectoral, so we have different supervisors for the banking, the capital markets, and the insurance sectors, regulatory agencies are closely coordinating and are discussing conduct issues, and even our issuances. We have parallel issuances in corporate governance, related party transactions, and even expectations from external auditors. So these issues, cross-sectoral issues, are being discussed bi-monthly by the financial sector regulators. The BSP is also evaluating the sales and marketing practices of our supervised financial institutions, and we have issued regulations in treasury operations and sales practices. We have also established specialist groups that will look at conduct-related concerns, specifically our anti-money laundering specialist group and the Financial Consumer Protection Department. The crisis in the past two decades shaped the regulatory frameworks that we have today for the banking industry. The changes implemented are all aimed at making our financial system more robust and resilient to shocks. Given our frameworks and foreshadowing the developments that will take place in the business environment, let me share some of our thoughts on the three key factors that will drive subsequent changes in the regulatory framework. We believe that these are conduct and culture issues still, continuing digitization in the industry, and changing market preferences. Conduct and culture issues will continue to influence the regulatory framework as the business environment becomes more competitive. Financial institutions will continue to change their business models to gain wider margins or recognize higher fees. As they venture into new businesses or change their business models, behavior will consequently change, particularly if the organization's culture is defined by generation of profits. These behaviors are reflections of the values and reactions to the incentive schemes of the organization. The recent issuance of the BSP on corporate governance actually provide the regulatory expectations on compensation schemes and regulatory governance, among others. The issuance highlights that the compensation and incentive scheme should be structured in such a way that it does not encourage excessive risk-taking. The expectations on risk governance, on the other hand, require the board of directors to set a risk appetite that should be within their capability to manage. Although regulatory expectations and safeguards are already in place, this will further be refined along with our supervisory approach as we observe practices and behaviors treading beyond the boundaries of prudence. Actually, there are a couple of jurisdictions already hiring psychologists as part of the supervisory team who observe board meetings actually and probe into the character and the values of specific board members. But we will not move into that. The second factor that will influence the regulatory landscape is the continuing digital transformation. Digitization is changing business models and platforms in delivering financial services. The digital age provides alternative means in reaching the unserved and underserved market, either as a standalone non-bank entity or as part and parcel of banking operations. Fintechs, or financial technology as we call it in the banking industry, is challenging traditional channels of delivering financial services and is promising enhanced efficiency at reduced cost. This may be likened to the Uber example of Dr. Lando. A popular approach is to welcome these developments and allow them to operate under a controlled environment. The BSP believes that the timing of technology-related issuances is critical to be able to strike a balance between controlling exposures to unidentified risks and ensuring that actions taken do not stifle innovation. In this respect, the timing of our issuances should be at such point when the BSP has understood the risks attendant to the product or the business model. In the early days of the e-money, we call this as the test and learn approach. And now it's more popularly known as the regulatory sandbox. Institutions that wanted to introduce fintech-based technologies are allowed to operate within a controlled environment to allow them and the regulators as well to better understand the risk and ensure that it will not expose the financial system to unknown or excessive risks. It is only after understanding this risk and the business models of the companies will the BSP issue the necessary regulations. So the e-money, we adopted the test and learn approach, and it was actually after 3 years when we issued the e-money regulations. The use of regulatory sandbox was also adopted in Singapore, Hong Kong, and the United Kingdom. Digitization is also opening doors to be more informed to the use of big data. This will provide richer insights on risk exposures and will better equip our regulators in formulating timely and relevant regulations. Currently, the big data challenge for regulators is how to determine what's appropriate and relevant without resulting in undue costs on the part of our supervised financial institutions. The last factor that would redefine the regulatory framework would be the changing market behavior. This may be largely influenced by the technological developments or search for higher yields. These are reactions to the changing business environment and the demand for more convenient services. The BSP actually spearheading the National Retail Payment System, which would, the vision is actually 2020, that is electronic payments by 20% of payments transaction would be done through electronic means in 2020. Because right now we have 2.5 billion transactions a month done through cash or check mode. And it's quite costly for the consumers. So currently only 2% of the 2.5 billion monthly transactions being done through electronic means. So the vision is 2020. Another significant change in market behavior that may influence the way financial institutions operate would be the public's demand for more disclosure. Supervision in New Zealand is largely anchored in disclosures of financial institutions. We believe that this regime reflects strong market discipline. Now, when institutions move towards this phase, the regulatory framework will be reframed, but this will definitely strengthen our oversight in the financial system. So all said, our regulatory framework is designed in such a way that our standards are aligned to the extent possible with international standards and practices, and at the same time, sensitive to the settings of the domestic financial system. In this respect, we will continue to adopt a consultative approach to be able to shape policies that are responsive to the local conditions and aligned with the directions of other financial sector supervisors. We will also further strive to strengthen our adoption of the proportionate approach to regulation and supervision. This is to ensure that we will be able to promote a safe and sound banking system and at the same time support innovation and inclusive growth. This ends my presentation. Thank you very much.